Hey everyone, welcome back to Dietitians and Nutrition Support. If you're a DNS member, you may be familiar with our support line publication that we put out every 2 months that provides articles specifically focused on nutrition support. If you are not a DNS member, you may never have seen any of these awesome articles before, which is a huge bummer. So we wanted to bring those articles to you today, and we actually have a free link to a PDF article in our comments boxes below. The specific article in question today is Considerations for Implementation of Enhanced Recovery After Surgery Programs for Kidney and Liver Transplant Patients. And not only do we have a free version of this awesome and very important article available for you, but we actually have the author with us here today to talk through all of the highlights of her article to help us really understand how we can use enhanced recovery after surgery or ERAS programs within liver and kidney patients. So I'm going to turn it over to the author, Rachel Ludke, and she's going to walk us through her paper.
Hello, my name is Rachel Ludke. I'm a dietitian at Frederick Hospital in Milwaukee, and I currently work in our transplant units, so mainly kidney and liver transplants. I created this paper for support line based on interest in my hospital implementing ERAS protocols. I've always been interested in ERAS because it is more of a preventative measure rather than a reactive measure. I feel like a lot of times in healthcare, we are reacting to problems, and ERAS is an opportunity to be preventative with the patient. I also created this paper because my surgeons have expressed interest in ERAS, and I wanted to create this as a resource for all transplant dietitians to go to one place to get all of the current information on transplant and ERAS and what that all entails and what research has already been done. So what is ERAS? ERAS is an enhanced recovery after surgery program. It's also been called a fast track surgery program. There are formalized guidelines for a lot of different surgical procedures like Whipples or GI cancer surgeries, and those are available through an ERAS society. But there aren't any formalized guidelines for transplant patients yet. ERAS focuses on both preoperative and postoperative interventions, and they're not just nutrition related. So some non-nutritional interventions may include preoperative physical or may include physical therapy, or intraoperative fluid management, or even like postoperative early Foley removal. The main nutritional components that I've seen through the ERAS protocols that I pulled out and specified in my paper are preoperative nutrition assessment, preoperative carbohydrate consumption, early postoperative diet advancement, and the inclusion of immunonutrition with postoperative diet or enteral nutrition. ERAS is beneficial to patients, transplant patients, because they are at high nutritional risk. We know that our patients have a high risk of pre or postoperative malnutrition development, and they have some other comorbid conditions that can raise their catabolic rate. So who would be a great patient to enroll in ERAS? First, there should be nutritional screening for all patients in the clinic to see if they would be a good candidate. There's no formalized nutrition assessment in the ERAS Society. Many surgical specialties do different nutrition assessments that may just be evaluating BMI, or it may be looking at doing physical exams on patients, looking at their fat or muscle mass, weight loss, their intake history. So it really depends on your center and what surgeons prefer and what you think as the dietitian is the best nutrition assessment for patients. If patients flag as being malnourished or maybe they're frail, they should be excluded from proceeding with surgery and the ERAS program, and focus should be on optimizing nutrition and overall mobility prior to moving into surgery. If you think your patient is nutritionally optimized and ready to go into surgery, then you should proceed with the ERAS protocol and look into starting preoperative interventions such as early preoperative carbohydrate consumption, which I'll go into a little later. So the three areas of ERAS in nutrition that I've identified as being major contributors in most ERAS protocols are preoperative carbohydrate consumption, early postoperative diet advancement, and the inclusion of immunonutrition. So, what does preoperative carbohydrate consumption look like? Traditionally, our patients are made NPO or nothing by mouth about 8 to 12 hours before surgery, and that's to reduce any kind of aspiration risk and ensure that they don't have a lot of gastric secretions. With ERAS, studies have found that patients can safely consume clear liquid carbohydrate drinks up to 2 hours before surgery without any increased risk in aspiration. So many centers are including a 50-gram carbohydrate drink up to 2 hours prior to surgery. In postoperative diet advancement, typically that is dependent on surgeon preference, or some centers go about on return of bowel function or gas formation before diet is advanced, and that's typically maybe a clear liquid diet first and then further progression over the next few days to solid food advancement. In ERAS protocols, diet advancement is done early in the postoperative period. It varies by studies, but some studies have going from a regular diet right on postoperative day one or early tube feeding advancement within the first couple days. And these studies have shown that these patients who have early postoperative diet advancement or tube feeding initiation actually have quicker GI recovery. They have they can have their nasal gastric tubes removed faster and overall a decreased length of stay. The third component, immunonutrition, varies in all the different ERAS protocols. Immunonutrition doesn't have a standard definition, but immunonutrients are things like omega-3 fatty acid, vitamin A or E, arginine, glutamine, things that are affecting the immune response or anti-inflammatory response. So many protocols are including immunonutrition to help with wound healing, lower inflammatory response for better glucose control. And many studies have shown a benefit in enhanced wound healing, lower incidence of infection rate, and overall a decrease in overall mortality. But most of these studies are done in trauma or surgical GI patients, so there aren't any studies done in transplant patients as of yet. So now we can go over the current state of ERAS in transplant patients. There currently aren't any guidelines from the ERAS Society for transplant patients, and the only surgical recommendations I've found in regards to nutrition for transplant patients come from ESPEN, who recommend that enteral nutrition or diet be initiated within 12 to 24 hours prior to surgery. Otherwise, there isn't much guidance on implementing diet pre or post transplant. And in this study, I just focused on kidney and liver transplant patients because that's the population I work for. And also kidney and liver transplants are often combined, whereas heart or lung or pancreas transplants are more of a singular surgery. And there's so much research that I wanted to keep this paper specific to two organ types. In kidney transplant patients, there are about three studies done on ERAS in this patient population. In these studies, they are all nutrition interventions for the postoperative period. So patients were given a diet early on postoperative day one. And all of these studies found a decrease in length of stay and an overall decrease in mortality. In kidney transplant donors, there was one study that looked at providing donors with a carbohydrate drink 4 hours prior to surgery compared to patients who were traditionally just NPO prior to surgery. And this study found that patients who were given that preoperative carbohydrate drink had a overall lower length of stay and a lower readmission risk. And finally, in our liver transplant patients, there were two small studies completed on ERAS in this patient population. The first study was done in patients who had a carbohydrate drink preoperatively and had an early diet advancement on postoperative day one. This study found that there was an overall 47% reduction in length of stay compared to patients who were in the pre-ERAS era group, so they didn't receive any pre- or postoperative nutrition intervention. The second study done should be noted that there was only 10 patients in the study and they all had very low MELD scores of about 7. This study initiated tube feeding early on postoperative day one, whereas the control group had no early enteral nutrition. The study found that there was actually no difference in complications or wound healing, but it did find that these patients had an overall lower intensive care unit stay, lower mortality rate, and an overall lower hospital length of stay. So although there are some studies in ERAS in transplant patients, it should be noted that these studies were all very small, anywhere from 10 to 40 patients. And many of these patients were transplanted when they weren't very sick, so that means they had low MELD scores. And it should also be noted that these studies didn't only look at nutrition. They were also implementing other ERAS interventions, so these studies can't be seen solely for nutrition interventions made with these patients. So how can we implement ERAS into our facilities for our transplant patients? There's a few considerations I went over in this paper. The first consideration is timing. With transplants, we usually never know when these surgeries are going to occur if they're coming from a deceased donor. I think ERAS would be best implemented in patients who have a living donor, usually in our kidney population where the surgery is going to be scheduled, and we know when these patients are going to be in clinic and when they're going to have their surgery so that we can line up their pre- and postoperative interventions. We could do ERAS in our deceased donor recipients, more so in the postoperative phase with things like early diet advancement or early tube feeding advancement or using immunonutrition. But I think the preoperative interventions would be hard to do when the timing of surgery is unknown. The second consideration is using immunonutrition in transplant patients. Transplant patients receive immunosuppressants after surgery to suppress their immune system so their body accepts that organ as their own. These immunosuppressants work by blocking T cell proliferation. And immunonutrition, specifically arginine, works to enhance T cell proliferation. So there's no studies out there that show if using immunonutrition blocks the effect of immunosuppression. So that is overall unknown at this time. A third consideration is, should we be using preoperative carbohydrate consumption with our patients that have diabetes? We know patients with diabetes can have delayed gastric emptying. So if we gave them a carbohydrate drink prior to surgery, would that still stay in their stomach and increase their risk of aspiration going into surgery? There are a few studies out there that look at patients with diabetes and doing preoperative carbohydrate consumption. And these studies found that patients were able to empty the contents in their stomach within 60 to 180 minutes if we follow these guidelines, allowing patients to consume carbohydrate beverages up to 4 hours before surgery. That would allow any patient to empty the drink within that 180 minutes. Lastly, and I think the most important consideration is collaboration with the transplant team. There are so many people involved in the transplant process: coordinators, organ procurement, nursing, pharmacists, social work, that implementing any kind of ERAS protocols needs to include every single person in the group to make sure it's implemented effectively. First, before implementing, we want to work with our surgeons to see what they're comfortable with implementing nutrition-wise, reviewing the current literature, and deciding on if you're just going to do preoperative intervention or if we're going to do both preoperative and postoperative, and what's available resource-wise at your facility. Next, you'll want to work with your transplant coordinators so that you can see your patients preoperatively in the clinic and do that nutrition assessment and explain what ERAS is to the patients. And if you're using a preoperative carbohydrate drink, how does that work? When should they consume it? So there's a lot of instruction that would need to be done preoperatively. Also, postoperatively, you'll want to have close collaboration with your nurses, CNAs, your surgeon, to make sure that you can initiate your diet on the appropriate day postoperatively and provide education with patients. So overall, a lot of moving pieces that need a lot of collaboration with different providers. But I think ERAS is important to implement in our transplant patients because they are high nutritional risk and they would benefit from receiving early nutrition to prevent that catabolic response that we know occurs in the postoperative period. Thanks for watching. I'm happy to take any questions in the comment section below, and I hope this video is something that you can use and implement at your facilities.